All right, we're looking at three-eyed Don. Three-eyed Don. Yep, there's one-eyed, two-eyed, three-eyed Don. Amen, that's what a black preacher said. Third Don, you know, the eyes, the Roman numeral, I, you know. Yep, the ones. Third John, this is quite an epistle. Amen. We've been looking at, Devin and Holly, we've been looking at the books in the Bible that are just one chapter. And so we've looked at Obadiah in the Old Testament. And
Jude?
Not yet. That's what's coming. We got Philemon. And then we have 2 John. Now we're at 3 John. And we get to Philemon, or to Jude next, Lord willing. Lord willing. All right, let's listen to the Word of God as I read it here. The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well, because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such that we may be fellow helpers to the truth. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith, neither doeth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Demetrius hath good report of all men, and of the truth itself. Yea, and we also bear record, and ye know that our record is true. I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet the friends by name. Father, I come before you and I thank you again that the saints have gathered here for some spiritual food in the middle of the week so that they can be refreshed, they can be energized and equipped to better serve you. And so I pray that you would work as only you can. I need that power of the Holy Spirit to give out spiritual food. Lord, not physical food. We've seen the words, but we want to hear from heaven this evening. And so just bless us. And thank you for what you're going to do. And Lord, please, please, may this be a great prayer meeting. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we've been looking at this epistle, and this is a great letter to us. And of course, we started out understanding that we're well-beloved. That's what the Scripture says there, and we that know Jesus Christ is our Savior. Jesus looks down and calls to us, well-beloved. And not only does he say it there in verse 1, but verse 2, he says, beloved. And verse 5, he says, beloved. And that's great when you think of the Trinity loving us. And, you know, just some great things there. And so we see this idea of walking in the truth and propagating the truth and making the truth go forward, verse 8, the end of it, that we might be fellow helpers to the truth. And the truth is what leads people to the Lord Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what it's all about. Not just having the truth in our brain, having some truths up here, but actually being able to give it out so that others can trust Jesus Christ as Savior. And that's a wonderful thing. And of course, the Apostle John is told by the Holy Spirit to tell Gaius through this letter, you know, that he's doing some things right. And this idea of hospitality is a good thing. We're supposed to be hospitable and open up our home to those that that need it, to open up our home to those that are doing the work of the Lord and that sort of thing. I know that there were a lot of times in my early growth as a Christian, when I was a baby Christian. Jeannie's dad and mom opened their home up to missionaries and evangelists. Mm-hmm. And so I got to sit, and I'd always sit right across from them. I mean, I would pick their brain. What about this? What about that? I read this in Scripture. What does that mean? What does that say? You know, how does that line up with what I read in this other book? And I mean, I just asked them all kinds of questions. Over and over again, you know, and that helped me to grow in Christ. But they had that gift of hospitality. And every year their church would put on a missions conference, and they would have 8-10 missionaries, something like that, plus their families. And Jeannie's dad and mom would always have a meal at the house for all of them. And, you know, just that idea of hospitality. A good thing, amen. Mm-hmm. Really a good thing, but we've got Diotrephes here. Uh-oh. And Diotrephes, you know, he's the picture of haughtiness, if you will. You know, he loveth to have the preeminence among them. You know, he just, that's what his characteristic. He just wanted to be preeminent. He wanted to be number one, stand out, so everybody saw him. And not only that, but he receiveth us not. That was a second charge that the Holy Spirit had John tell us about Diotrephes. Not only does he need to have the preeminence, and we know in Colossians chapter 1, verse 18, that it says there that in all things Christ would have the preeminence, that he's the one to have the preeminence. But Diotrephes, and then he would not receive, you know, John, wouldn't receive him, wouldn't let him come. Didn't want him there at the church. You know, that's not a good thing. And then a third thing is that he talked bad about the apostles. John was instructed, wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds. And we noted that if I come is kind of strong there, because he said in verse 13, I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write to thee, but I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. So, you know, he's coming. When I come, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words. We don't know what he said, but, you know, I get the feeling that he said, why, these traveling preachers, you know, these missionary types, I mean, they're just mooches. That's all they are. They're just, leeches. They're just trying to suck the life out of us. We're Christians in this world. It's hard for us to live in this world. And, you know, for us to make ends meet and all. And these are coming along. They're trying to take the food right out of our mouth, out of the mouths of our babies. I don't know what he said, but they were malicious words, if you can imagine. And not only that, but a fourth charge that we see here is that he refused the hospitality of missionaries. And it said there in verse 10, and not content therewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren. He just won't have them either. Mm. You know? So who knows? Maybe he had that Calvinistic idea already back then, before Calvin. Mm. You know, maybe he had that kind of an idea that God's supreme and God's going to save who he's going to save. He's going to draw them. And if they're not drawn, it's not worth even bothering to go after them. And all, there's people that say, I mean, there's churches that say Baptist in the name of the church that do not support missionaries, don't have a track rack anywhere, don't go out and try to win people to Christ. They honestly believe, Raph, that the saved are going to come walking through the door and walk to the altar and get saved. Just incredible. In some way or other, they've missed out Scripture, I believe. They just have to ignore a lot that's in the Word of God. But they refuse them. And then, of course, the fifth thing that the Apostle John said about him there is that he forbiddeth them that would and casteth them out of the church. So if this were the situation, and I'm Diotrephes, and Holly, you had a missionary stay at your house, I'd cast you and Devin out of the church. You'd be churched. You'd be excommunicated. You'd be voted out for doing that. Can you imagine? That's a terrible thing, you know. Those are the terrible things. So, is it any wonder now that this evening we come to verse 11 and it says, "Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good." You know, sometimes people in a church setting find that so-and-so seems to be doing this or that, and boy, that seems to be working for them, and they're getting their own way and all this stuff. Maybe we ought to do the same thing. You know, maybe. I had in one of the churches, this fellow that would sit there and he'd write notes while I'm preaching. And he'd pass the note down the row. You know? What he just said is heresy. I saw one of the notes. What he just said is heresy, and passed that down the line. You know? So what do you think? Well, oh boy, that's pretty good. Look at the following he's got. Well, we'd like to have some people follow us, think of us as great. Let's see if we can do that kind of same thing. We'll get in on that, huh? You know, whatever. You know, it's easy to get beguiled and think, well, wow, that seems to be working. Why don't we do that? You know. Why don't we work together and we'll tell all these people, we'll get so-and-so elected as a deacon, and then we'll have a majority of deacons that think we ought to do this, because that's what I think we ought to do, and then they'll be able to outvote the pastor. Of course, in Diotrephes' church, that wouldn't work. Diotrephes was like the Wizard of Id, you know, and the king and the Wizard of Id, you know, they had... they had his little bodyguard there. He yells from the parapet of the castle. He yells to all the people, "And what is your vote?" And they all go, "Yay!" And then he turns to the king, "And what is your vote?" And the king goes, "Nay." And it's this little word, "Nay." And he says, "Oh, the nays have it." You know, yeah, that's Diotrephes church. Amen. But, you know, we need to be admonished not to follow that which is evil. Because it's easy. It seems like that works. And you want to be a deacon in that church, well, you have to show off that you got money and all that kind of thing. They'll elect you as a deacon. Now, you ought to be spiritual. Mm-hmm. That's what you ought to be. I was at one church where the spiritual men, they didn't know what to do with them, so they made them trustees. Yeah. And the non-spiritual men that were, you know, these power-hungry kind of guys with all the money, they made them deacons. I thought, something's wrong with this picture. Amen? Something's wrong with this picture. So you know what happened, Miss Mary? Mm-hmm. They had a fight all the time. The deacons would say, "Well, we want to bring so-and-so in." And the trustees would say, "We don't have the money." Mm-hmm. Hmm. But we want to bring them in. Well, sorry, we don't have the money. You know, there's a battle going on. Had to straighten that thing out, amen? So, follow not that which is evil, but remember, every time Scripture tells us, you know, to remove something, it always tells us to put something back mm-hmm. in its place.
Right.
We're to put off the old man and put on the Lord Jesus Christ, amen? You know, that's the kind of thing. You know, you get rid of sin, well then put some good things in your life. So, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. See some good, follow it. Amen. That's what we need to do. Then it goes on here in verse 11, and this is quite incredible. "He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God." Wow. I mean, if you just look at that like that, you think, well, you know, I mean, I've done evil. Amen. My wife's just said, yes, I've done evil.
We all have.
Oh, she says we all have. You know? I don't make it a practice to do evil. At least I don't think so. I try not to. Isn't that how it should be with each one of us? We don't make it a practice to do evil. We try to do as much Christ-like as we can. Isn't that how it ought to be? Well, but then there's once in a while... You know, to my shame, you know, once in a while I don't don't do everything perfect. You know, and I confess it right away and that kind of thing. But this is saying here, he that doeth, you know, doeth. Is that past tense? If it were past tense, it'd be he did. Is it future tense? He will do. No, what tense is it? It's present tense. In the present, in your life, as you're going along, in the present tense, are you trying to do good? Are you trying to do evil? You know, what is it? Day by day by day by day, you know, you doeth good, doeth good, doeth good. But there's others that do evil, and they do that day by day by day by day. And sometimes even their good is for evil purposes. You know, we've talked about that recently in one of my sermons, that the, you know, some people will do good because it boosts their pride, or they'll do good so people recognize them, or they'll do good so they get something else in return for it. You know, this is the person that's doing good just to do good because God's in them. They're doing good because they walk in truth. Isn't that what the epistle was all about here? Mm-hmm. There's some blessings about walking in truth and carrying forth the truth. You know, and you only get the truth if the Lord Jesus Christ is in you. And that's the kind of person. But he that doeth evil hath not seen God. He's saying about Diotrephes, he hadn't even seen God. To do that kind of evil where I can find five things against him, mm-hmm. you know, that he consistently does. He hasn't seen God. You know, he doesn't really know who God is. You know, there's a lot of people think they know who God is, but they think of him not as the God of this Bible, but a God of their imagination. Yeah. Well, God's too good to send people to hell. Really? That's not in the Bible. His anger is with them every day. His wrath abides on them. You know, he makes the way of transgressors hard. Mm-hmm. You know? I mean, those kinds of things are there about God. But their mind is, well, you know, he would never do that. You know? Or he would never punish me because I've sinned. You know, I can confess it and the consequences of it are never going to bother me. Well, that's not what his word says. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So they've not seen God. They've seen who they think is God. Their idea of who God is, they haven't seen God. You know, if they say that, well, Jesus became a God, do you think they've really seen God? Nope, they haven't seen God. Oh yeah, I'm a follower of God. What do you think about Jesus? Oh yeah, Jesus was a great teacher and a great man. And he got so good that he was elevated to become a God. Yeah, you're a follower of God, not the one that I know. You know. Sure, I'm a follower of God. What do you think of Jesus? Oh, he's Satan's brother. And there is a yin-yang kind of thing going on. They're equal powers. And, you know, whoever you follow, that's who, you know, you'll get blessings from. So some people can follow Satan, some people can follow Jesus, and they're brothers. Really? That's not the God that I know. Isn't that true? They've never seen God. He that doeth evil hath not seen God. That's pretty strong words. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, in his first epistle, he said some of those same kind of things. You know, he said some things there, where God are manifest and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. So what do you think about Diotrephes? Does he love his brother? He won't put him up, won't give him a meal, won't help him with, you know, a piece of silver, a coin of Rome, you know, to get him on his way to his mission field. You know, he doesn't love his brother. Does not righteousness, you know, to speak those malicious words and prating. You know, that prating is that, you know, like being proud of it, you know. Wow. Yeah, same kind of thing. But come back to 3 John and notice here that we've got a contrast. We've been looking at Diotrephes, and now we come, verse 12, to this fellow Demetrius. And there's not much known about Demetrius. We don't know anything about his parents, don't know where he lived, don't know where his mission field was, not much about him except that he must be one of those that have been sent out and are trying to walk in the truth and trying to get the truth to other people, you know, journeying on his way, Demetrius. And his name means that he's a son of Dimitri. And apparently that's some form, some way, it's connected to some god, you know. So, you know, let's suppose that, you know, Raph had named his son Jupiter. You know, Jupiter's not only a planet, but also a god, right? You know, if he named him Mars, you know, same way.
In Iceland, his son would have been named Mars-son.
yeah.
Their names change with every generation.
Isn't that something?
Well, yeah. They have father's first name.
Father's first
name.
Son. And the
That's
son.
How their names are, like Ericsson, Leifson, Spencer.
Sure. Oh, yeah, sure.
And the wife doesn't change the name because...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So apparently he was named after some god but got saved out of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as a Gentile, got saved out of it. You know. And, you know, there's times when I thought that we ought to take a different name when we trust Christ as our Savior. Ought to find a good Bible name. You know, like Tiglath-Pileser. Isn't that a good Bible name? I noticed one boy was saying, "Oh, Dad, you know, I don't really like the name you gave me." He said, "Well, I could have named you Tiglath-Pileser." You know, kid walked away from the Lord. Amen. Demetrius hath good report of all men.
Mm.
Whew. Wow, that's quite the statement.
Wow.
Everywhere he goes, everybody says he's doing good. He's living as Christ-like as we've ever seen anybody live. Wow, that's quite a testimony. I wish that they could say that about me. That's an incredible testimony. Demetrius hath good report of all men and of the truth itself, of spreading the gospel, knowing how to tell people about Christ. You know, it's amazing. It really is. I'm always amazed at the difference between my giving out a gospel tract and an evangelist giving out a gospel tract.
Mm-hmm.
It's just amazing. I give out a gospel tract, say, "Here, I've got something for you to read." The evangelist says, "Here, something for you to read, tell you how to get to heaven through the Lord Jesus Christ." His brother John says that all the time.
Mm.
You know, and they go, "Oh, thank you." You know, when they do take it. Okay, I've got time, and I'll read it later. And they put it in their pocket. It's just amazing. Amen? He's got a good report of the truth itself. Mm. You know, the gospel is going out. People are getting saved. You know, that report comes back. Maybe he's been there, you know, or is going to, you know, the church where Gaius is at. And so the Apostle John wants him to know that this is a good man, you can trust him, and he'll be a help to you. You know, just a wonderful thing, amen? And then we read there in verse 12, "Yea, and we also bear record." Now when the Apostle John says "we," you know, he's got to include himself in that, and some others. So if I wrote a letter and said "we," you know, other kind of thing. I mean, I wrote a letter for Brother Devin here to his church that he's going to in South Carolina. I said, "We recommend him." Amen? And so the "we" means me and everybody else. So, you know, the apostle is saying, "Yea, and we also bear record." You know, we will tell you, we've got it marked down, this man is a good man.
Mm.
This fellow Demetrius, he hath good report of all men. And then he goes on and says, "And ye know," the "ye" being singular here, speaking back to Gaius, "and ye know that our record is true." Everybody that we've ever sent to you and said they will do you right, they've always done you right. You know, if I were to say to a pastor, you can have Brother Don Hardman in, he'll do your church right every single time. And you know what? He'll do the church right. Isn't that true? Mm-hmm. You know, you just have that kind of a record. And we bear him record. And of course it ought to be that I could send any one of you to a church and say about you, you know, that you have a good report, you know, among us here and of course of the truth itself. Good at soul winning. Ought to be. So we've got quite the contrast in verses 11 and 12 with what we had in verse 9 and 10. The contrast between Diotrephes and Demetrius. Big contrast that we have there. So, beloved, you get the choice, verse 11 says. Do you want to follow Diotrephes or do you want to follow Demetrius? That's the choice you get. You get that choice every day, all through the day. Who do you want to follow? You know, do you want to follow that which is evil or that which is good? Do you want to follow the one who wants the preeminence and has malicious words and forbiddeth them and casteth them out? Or do you want to follow one that hath a good report of all men and of the truth itself? You know, who do you want to follow? It's there. He that doeth good is of God. Demetrius. But he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Diotrephes. And sometimes we have to be careful because in churches you'll find a Diotrephes. And then you got a Demetrius. Mm-hmm. And you know the thing about Demetrius? Like I said, we don't know anything about him other than he's got his name here. Mm. God recorded it for us here, wrote it down. You know, some people need to learn that they can just do a whole lot of things behind the scenes. God sees it. Mm-hmm. Right. God will make note of it. There's a lot of people that, you know, they want, boy, they'll do it, but sure, that pastor is better, he had better, you know, prayed them across the platform, make a big show of it. You know, I've always thought, and, you know, I think at this point I could do it, you know, that somebody says, I want to sing a special. I say to them, okay, you go out there in the hallway, and Tony will give you the microphone, and you can sing it out there, and we'll hear it in here. You willing to sing it out there, around the corner? How long is your microphone cord, Tony? 100-footer, sing it 100 feet away. You know? So that you don't get the preeminence, so that you're not the show. But the Lord Jesus and the words of that song are the thing that we really want to be lifted up. Yeah. I mean, anymore, you go into churches and see these soloists. You know, they don't stay for church. They just come sing the solo and go home. Hmm. They got the microphone. They hold it like the Hollywood and country western people hold it. And, you know, they're having this intimate thing with their microphone. And, you know, the big show. You know. Mm. And then all the people shout amen. Yeah. What if they stood in the back of the church and nobody saw them and they sang? Be a whole lot better. Amen? Let the people just think about God. Think about those words. Hoo-wee. Yeah. So, you know, that's it. That's all I've got. I open it up for questions or comments. Yes, Devin.
I kept going. When we look at verse 10, and it talks about
Diotrephes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Right there at the colon, it says, and not content therewith, neither does he that receive the brethren. Is it that he's prating against us with malicious words and he's not content therewith to just say that and let it be, or in that he keeps going therein?
Yeah, he's not content to just let that be, but he goes on farther. Yes, okay. You're exactly right. Yep. Yep, exactly right. Yeah, that it's not just enough that he says those things, but he goes on further. Yep. Yeah, that's exactly right. Not content, just make a noise about it. But he goes on and doesn't receive the brethren and cast them out, you know, because he forbids the whole church. Nobody in the church can have anybody in their home. Yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm. Like I know the Flyings. I'm trying to think what the pastor's name is. But you know some other pastors. Of course, there was that brother from Pennsylvania, which I haven't heard from in years and years. But you know, if they needed a place, they're coming through and they called you because they know you. You'd put them up. I have great blessing. Praise God. You know, they're at the Flyings' house. They put them up. Wonderful. Yeah. That's a good thing. Yeah. Isn't that terrible? I can't think of his name.
Garner. John Garner.
Garner, yes, that's John and Joyce. Garner. Oh. John Garner. Yeah. So, you know, and I would think, you know, that if he's an uncle to you, isn't he, Brother Scott? Yes. I just read the letter. He's an uncle to you. You know, if he came, you know, down there to South Carolina, you know, you two put him up. We have no qualm about it. You know, the church should be glad. Oh, wow. You know, Devin and Holly put up the missionary. Wonderful. What a good thing. Yep, what's that?
Yes, we put up with the missionary.
Yeah, you put up with the missionary. Yeah. With Uncle Paul. Uncle Tay Paul, I guess you have to call him, you know. The Vietnamese name there, huh? But, you know, that's, you know, but if I heard that they had put up the gardeners and they throw them out of the church for that, something wrong with that picture. Big wrong with that picture. A couple of reasons why it's wrong. I shouldn't have that kind of power, number one. Mm-hmm. All right? Number two, we ought to be hospitable, and we looked at that as we studied it before. Okay, any other questions or comments?
Sounds like these Jobels seem personal right there. You know, some of the big mega churches.
Yeah, these mega churches, yeah. The preeminence kind of thing.
Show.
Yeah.
Almost looks like the next book where it says, where there are certain men crept in unawares.
Yes. Yep. Ungodly men, turning the grace of our God unto lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. And he calls them in verse 12 of Jude, you know, they're clouds, they are without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruit withereth without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea foaming out their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Yeah. It wouldn't surprise me to see some of those kind of TV evangelists, you know, standing there saying, Lord, Lord, we did all these things in your name. Mm-hmm. That great white throne judgment, he said, depart from me, I never knew you.
Well, we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
That's right.
And if Satan, I beheld Satan as an angel of light falling from heaven. You know, if it's possible, the most dangerous part of Satan is what? His religious side.
That's exactly right.
Turning his ministers into an angel of light.
So, because Joel Osteen doesn't believe in hell.
Okay. Wow.
Right. He was on some show and I asked him about people going to hell. And he, oh, no. So,
believe what he wants.
Well, even if he didn't go that far and just say that, he's been given multiple chances on public broadcast stations to proclaim Jesus Christ fully.
Sure.
Plenty of times and hasn't.
Hasn't. Yep. Comes back to that truth thing here. Okay. Demetrius and of the truth itself. You know, the gospel, as we looked at earlier about what the truth is. You know, it's the gospel. Yeah. Jesus Christ died, was buried, rose again the third day, according to the scriptures for our sins, shed his blood to pay for our sins. You know, Yep, God in the flesh. That's what it is. So good. All righty. Thank you, dear ones. I sure appreciate that.